Hello, everybody. How's everybody doing? So, yeah, this is me. I'm Marty O'Donnell. I'm an audio director and composer for video games. And we're going to talk about navigating a career in the video game industry, especially when it involves audio and music. How many people here are 25 or younger? Okay, it's quite a few. Okay, good. So your careers are just laid out in front of you. So the thing I want to sort of discuss more than anything is that everybody's path to whatever their career goal is different. And I had a very circuitous route. My path was windy and twisty. And I just want to encourage everybody, you're in college or you're just out of college, and all sorts of things are going to happen in your life, and you never know what's going to happen. And there's a Japanese poet named Basho from the 17th century, and he's famous for saying, "Do not seek to follow in the footsteps of the wise. Seek what they sought." And I kind of wish I had, you know, I had known that better when I was younger, because a lot of times I just wanted to do what I saw other people doing. So I'm not saying that I'm one of the wise. I'm saying you can look at my path and see that it went all over the place. And almost nobody just has a straight shot to something they're seeking. Almost always you're coming to forks in the road, and you take the left, and you take a right, and then some magic decision happens. And it's once you have as long a career as I've had, you look back on it and you can see how there's many different choices that you make that change what you end up doing. So I'm going to give you a sort of a background on what my life was like. My mother and father were both really creative people. My dad was an actor. He was a singer. He was a radio personality, and he directed movies. He was a film director. So I grew up with my dad directing movies. My mother was an accomplished musician, pretty much classically trained. She was a really, really talented pianist and a piano teacher. So I never heard them say to me, "You can't make a living doing that," which is a gift. I don't know how many of you have heard somebody in your family at some point saying, "Well, why are you interested in that? You can't make a living doing that. If you're an artist, what are you doing drawing pictures? You can't make a living doing that. If you're playing with games, if you're programming, programming, most people think you can make a living doing that. But if you say, "I want to be a games programmer," it's like, well, that's kind of weird, right? But I never got that from my parents at all. "You can't make a living doing that," which meant that I was probably kind of an annoying kid because I was free to be creative. I gravitated towards piano and music. I loved music. And my parents were just really sweet people. So I see this picture and I'm like, boy, that he must have been really an annoying little kid. One day my dad brought home an album of a movie that was out. The movie had come out a few years earlier, but I'd never seen it. And he brought home this album and I put it on and played it. And this is what I heard. So I looked at the pictures on this album and I tried to imagine what the scenes were. I heard this music, it affected me emotionally. And my hero then suddenly became this guy here, Nicholas Rosa, which is kind of weird to think of, like a 4 or 5 year old kid having this guy as his hero. But like, it wasn't so much that I wanted to be a film composer at that moment. What I wanted to be able to do is I wanted to be part of creating music that could make people have the same emotional response as I had. And of course, it didn't take too much longer. A few years went by, and I started hearing some other music. So just like millions of other kids around the world, I started a band because I was convinced that that's what I needed to do. I needed to be a rock star because the Beatles just blew me away. Of course, that didn't happen. But, you know, I still had this love of classical music, and I wanted to be a rock star. So this is sort of strange confluence of emotions about music. But I ended up going ahead and being a music major. I was a piano performance major at Wheaton College Conservatory of Music, which is a school just outside of Chicago, Illinois. And I was a piano major and played Brahms, Bach, Beethoven, Chopin. Here's a little Brahms. And I played some Debussy. Anybody know this piece? Here we go. But I was still like, I still had a band while I was in college. And so as I'm working hard at being a piano major and playing all the right things that the teachers wanted me to play, I had this band and I wanted to see if there was a way to be in a rock band that also satisfied my urge to be serious about music. So of course I gravitated to prog rock, especially Emerson, Lincoln, Palmer. Keith Emerson was a classically trained pianist, organist, absolute monster player. And they did versions of Copland, Bartok, Mussorgsky. It's just crazy what they did. And progressive rock just really attracted me. And so I had a band, and we covered a lot of progressive rock stuff, Genesis, Gentle Giant, King Crimson, Jethro Tull. And I sort of understand this. Is it true it's those guys are sort of making a comeback amongst the kids a little? Well, I see somebody shaking his head, so that's good. It was really amazing to hear this music and then cover it. One day when I was 19, though, the drummer in my band said, "Hey, Marty, you keep teaching us all this complex music. You keep figuring all this music out. Why don't you just try writing some music for this band?" And so there I am at age 19, and I'm like, well, no one's ever said, no one's even given me permission to write music. So I said, okay, let me give that a shot. So the name of the band that we had was the Digital Benders, which is, I don't know, just hilarious to me. But because this is before digital anything, but digital was sort of a term that was coming in, so that was cool. Plus, we bent our fingers when we played, right? See, digital? Okay. So I went upstairs. I remember this because we rehearsed in the basement, and I wrote this piece, and I just found this. This is a tape that I just found in the last year. I'd forgotten that I even had a tape of this. So here's a little excerpt of something. This is actually the very first thing I ever wrote for my prog rock band. That was really exciting. I thought, this is really cool. I love writing music. I don't want to be a piano performance major anymore. I went to the dean of the conservatory and said, I'm changing my major to composition. And he was like, you'll never get a degree. You don't have enough time to take all the right classes to get this degree. And I said, that's okay. I don't really need a degree because I'm going to be a rock star. So, so you can see a lot of my plans never quite came through. But I did get the degree in the 4 years, composition degree. It was a really hard thing to do. And I enjoyed it so much, I decided to go to grad school. So I went to USC School of Music, which is in Southern California, and got my master's in music composition. And there I learned a lot more about music theory, of course, composition, but music theory, orchestration, counterpoint, you know, all the different instruments and how they work, music techniques. I also learned, got better at music calligraphy. So this is actually, that's my score. That's a handwritten score for a series of piano pieces that I did. So it's fun. It's funny because I feel like this is sort of a lost art. I'm kind of glad that I did calligraphy with music notation, because almost nobody does this anymore, because we have computer programs that do it all for us. I mean, they don't exactly do everything for us, but they do a lot. So here's a little piece of that piano piece that I did. So, yeah, I got my master's in music composition. I was very serious about music now. I had sort of lost my desire to be a prog rock star. There weren't a whole lot of prog rock stars now that I think of it, so I don't know what I was thinking. But I went back to Chicago because I thought I was going to get a job in the film as a teacher. I was very serious about academics. So I was going to get a job at the American Conservatory of Music as a composition teacher, a theory teacher. And while I was waiting for that, I worked on a film set and was a grip. So do you all know what a grip is? Person that runs cable and sets lights. And because I had grown up with my father being a film director, it was sort of a natural thing for me to do. So one day while I was working as a grip, the producer of the movie we were working on, and these are not glamorous movies. This is commercial kind of, it was a movie for Sears. Sears is a department store. So anyway, so really exciting movie, as you can imagine. But anyway, the producer came to me and said, "Marty, you have a master's in music composition. Why don't you go ahead and write music for, you know, film productions and commercials and stuff in Chicago?" And I'm like, and I said this with all seriousness at that moment. I said, "Well, I don't want to prostitute my art." And I meant it seriously. And, you know, she accepted that. And this is the absolute truth. The very next day on the same film set, the director came to me and said, "Marty, hey, I got $500 I'll give you if you score this film." I'm like, "Yes." So I just, no one had actually offered me money before, right? And so I just didn't know what my price was. And of course, it turned out that I was a lot cheaper than $500 because I had no way of producing anything. So I went to my friend Mike Salvatore, and this is his basement studio, and I knew he had a basement studio. I knew he had some equipment around. And I said, "Hey, Mike, I'll split $500 with you if you write some music with me and we produce some music." And he says, "Sure." So that was the beginning of our partnership, which was lasted decades. That night, we actually wrote and produced like 5 songs. Here's the very first thing we ever produced together. It's not exactly Brahms or the Beatles or Beethoven, but here it is. So I don't know, any of you know, anybody recognize any of the instruments in there, musicians in the audience? There's an old TR-808, which is also known as just the 808. I still have it. Apparently, it's worth a lot of money. It was a Prophet Pro 1, which was a monophonic synthesizer, single voice, and a Casio keyboard. And that's what we did. And what was fun is that we sold everything we did that night. We had 5 songs as demos. And we ended up scoring the film. We ended up having one of the pieces on a commercial almost within days. It was on TV. And I thought, well, this is easy. Like anybody, this is great. Let's just drop everything and do this. And of course, we almost immediately had no jobs after that first initial thing. So then we realized it's actually a hard thing to do, to get more work. One of the things we got was a job for McDonald's. I love the sound design in this room, by the way. This is great. This is happening all at the same time. I don't know if you guys are sensitive to audio. I'm hearing all these creaking noises. Anyway, we got this job for McDonald's, and the assignment was take the McDonald's jingle, and this is the jingle. You deserve a break today, so get out and get away to McDonald's. Yeah, this nobody recognizes that, especially all you kids. It's an old, old jingle. But the assignment was, can you do it sort of in a classical mode? And I thought, this is great. So I decided to take the McDonald's jingle melody and stick it inside of Beethoven's Eroica Symphony. And I'm sure nobody had ever done that before, and I'll play you a little bit. But we did it on the Prophet 5 synthesizer with a poly sequencer, and Mike's wife, Gail, who was a violinist, and we recorded the heck out of her. We just recorded her playing violin over and over and over. And this is what it sounded like. So that actually led to a lot more jobs, and we built a studio downtown Chicago. I love this picture because this just so dates what we were doing. Every piece of gear had wood on it, and of course then we had to put wood paneling up on the wall. So like it was a very woody thing at that time. Everything was wood. Of course, all you see are tape machines. There was no digital audio at that point. But that led to some other jingles. We did jingles for years. One of the jingles, if anybody here is from America and is older than 40 years old, you'll know this jingle. So I'm going to play it for you. So in America, in the States, if you have a slightly older audience, everyone will sing "and growing" at the end because they all grew up and they all heard that jingle forever. And by the way, that was my daughter when she was 5 years old singing "and growing," and she's now 40. Okay, so, fast forward a few more years, we've got a nice new studio. We're successful. We're doing TV commercials. Notice how I haven't even come close to games yet. This is pretty amazing. But I was playing games at the time, but I never thought games were a thing because it was the games that were available at the time didn't have much production value to them at all. But one night I was working with Mike and we were working on, the client was coming in the next morning and we needed to show them this music for a commercial that had a claymation animated cat in it. And we were very serious about it. You know, it was woodwinds and a bunch of stuff. And I remember we were arguing about what to do, what instrument to use when the cat did something with its finger. And all of a sudden, it just like a ton of bricks, I'll never forget it, hit me. Oh, I have prostituted my art. And let me just show you the commercial. I can't believe I found this online, so it still exists. It's not just a claymation cat, but it's what the product is. It's kitty litter.
Cat 3, with the power to absorb odors and deodorize for a fresh, clean scent. Making Tidy Cat 3 the number one cat box filler in America. So whether you have one of these or lots of them, all you need is one of these. The Tidy Cat Team Clobbers Cat Box Odor.
Yeah, kitty litter. So then it sort of dawned on me, like we were making good money and we were getting commercials on national TV, but I was doing music to sell kitty litter. And it's like, it just wasn't satisfying. And I couldn't see me doing that the rest of my life. Thankfully, a friend of mine's son, who was at the time, he was 18 years old, came to visit. He wanted to see the studio and he noticed that I like video games, computer games. So he said, I have a beta version of a cool game that I'd love to show you. Let's see. You know what? Let me know when I'm at a half hour or so point. The timer on here is not working. Oh, maybe it's over there. Yeah, okay. Anyway, so he came and he showed me this game. Myst. And I listened to the soundtrack to Myst. I played this game. It was a beta version of the game, so it hadn't been out for very long. It hadn't even come out yet. So I didn't know anything about it, but I heard audio and music in there, and I thought, that's something I'd love to do. I thought it was too late. I thought I was too old. I thought it was too late to change careers, but I thought I need to get into that business. So I sent the guys who made Myst, I sent them a track that was started with their music, and then we took off from there. So it sounded like this. And they were interested in working with us, and we had this nice, beautiful studio that we had built over the years with the pool table. We ended up doing Riven, the sequel to Myst. If anybody's seen that, it's an older game, but it's a beautiful game. And we ended up getting the job to do Myth: The Fallen Lords, Myth 2: Soulblighter, and another game called Subterra Core. So now we were officially doing a lot of game stuff, game audio and music. And by the way, I'm going to play you just a little bit of the Myth 2 epilogue. And for those of you who know what I've done, you might recognize a little something. So this was in 1998, and here's the music. Our studio burned to the ground. We lost tons of our recordings, all of our stuff, in the middle of working on all this stuff. So we ended up having to go back to Mike's basement again. And in Mike's basement, we were working on the next project for Bungie. And we had to write this in Mike's basement. So this is what this was. So this was for, we showed this, you can keep the audio up, it's good. We showed this at Macworld 1999, New York, and that got us the job. We ended up getting purchased by Microsoft to launch on the Xbox, and we did Halo 2, Halo 3, Halo 3 ODST, and Halo Reach. Which is great because I just signed a bunch of copies of those games just before the talk. And that led, Bungie ended up being at Microsoft for almost 7 years. I was a Microsoft employee for 7 years. We got our independence back during that period, and eventually we ended up making Destiny. And I got to work with one of my childhood heroes. I got to work on this game and on the on the music, collaborating with Paul McCartney, which was a dream come true. Just amazing. So now I'm gonna back up a little bit just to give you a little more technical detail. I'm the audio director and composer on all the games that I've produced. An audio director. The meaning behind audio director is the person who is basically the creative director for all the audio and music that comes out of a game. So anything that comes out of the speakers is basically my creative vision. So that doesn't mean I do everything. It just means that there's a singular vision for the creative product that has to do with anything that comes out of the speakers or you hear on the headphones. I've had a great team of collaborators over the years, obviously, Paul McCartney being one. I work with the writers on the story. I work directing the actors in the studio, implementing the audio. And as a composer, I pretty much write all the themes to whatever game I'm working on and work with my partner Mike and other musical collaborators. But the most important thing is for me is the implementation. Because in video games, it's not like scoring a movie. A movie score is linear. We call that linear media. So linear media, you know exactly the timeline of when everything's going to happen. You know that music starts here, the car crashes here, the girl kisses the guy here, and then the house blows up over here, and then you're done. That happens the same way every time you score that. You know exactly where it's all going to happen. In a video game, it's all dependent upon what the player does. So we have to be able to make audio and music especially that adapts to what the player is doing. And for us, for me especially, the most important thing is to make sure that that emotional journey of the player is scored. And if the emotional journey of the player is scored, the player is going to feel like they were the star of their own movie. And the other important thing is to never let the player know that their actions are actually affecting the music. So one of the things, I have a saying for this industry, which is sound makes it real, music makes you feel. And that's pretty much correct. There are times, of course, where the sound makes you feel something and the music can bring things to life. But the music is the thing that really directly connects with your emotions. And so it's really important to connect with emotions. I have an example, though, of something about sound making it real. When I was working on Riven, I'll never forget, we had this animated thing that came in that we had to do sound design for, and it looked like this. This is from Riven. You're inside a giant yellow dome. You've just solved this puzzle, and this is the reward you get. There it is. So we need to sound design that. We did a sound design for it, and I remember Robin Miller came back to me and he said, Marty, you missed the most important thing is when those giant rods come slamming into the side. And I'm like, giant rods come slamming into the side? Did anybody see it? All right, let's watch it again. Giant rods. There. I said, you mean those little white pixels that came in? And he goes, yeah. He says, it's the climax of the whole machinery coming alive, and it's all happening inside the dome around you. And these are like 30-foot-long rods that come slamming in, and then this explosion happens, and the entire five islands that you've been working with are powered up. So, of course, I couldn't tell any of that just by looking at the animated thing. So we had to bring that to life. So this is what we ended up doing, which shipped. It's all happening around you someplace. So I think you can see, animation is important, but sometimes the audio can really bring something to life. And then the other part of my saying is music makes you feel. And I want to talk to you a little bit about the Halo monk chant. When we got the assignment to work on Halo, the writer for the piece, for the game, Joe Staten, and I were working on this demo that we were going to do for Steve Jobs. And I said, what do you want the audience to feel? And Joe said, the audience needs to feel like this is something ancient, epic, and mysterious. And I remember those three words. They were great words for a musician to listen to and say, how do I make people feel ancient, epic, and mysterious? Well, epic is, chugging cellos and percussion and mysterious was going to be, I thought, well, I'll do some sort of crazy vocal thing that feels sort of alien and mysterious. And then for ancient, it was like, oh, well, what makes you feel ancient? Well, Gregorian monks, Gregorian chant monks. Immediately, as soon as you hear that, it's old, 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 thousand years old. So I knew how to do Gregorian chant stuff. I knew I needed to do something, a melody that would be in Dorian, for example, which is a old church mode. But one of the things I wanted to do is I wanted to make sure that it was a sticky melody. It would be a melody that could last. And so I thought, well, what's a good melody that I can model the structure of my melody over? So once again, going back to Paul McCartney's Yesterday, the reason, and I didn't imitate Paul McCartney's Yesterday melody, I used what his structure was as something that sort of inspired me. And he's got four irregular phrases, and he's got a nice shape to the melody. It's got a low point, one low point, and one high point. So yesterday, da da da, this is far away. No. Oh, I believe in yesterday. So I came up with that in the car, went to Mike's house, said, here's what, let's do this. And he says, like, yeah, let's go. So this is going to be a little behind the scenes, the MIDI files, what we did to put this thing together. And you'll hear some of the soloed instruments for the Halo music we did that day. We had a weekend to do it. There's those fake voices. Percussion. You can make this louder if you want. High strings, still MIDI. It's just the cello soloed up. Just the high strings. A crazy voice. Here's the final mix with full orchestra. Six more strings. Thing about this melody is still being used today, 23 years later. It's going to be on Paramount TV, it's in all the games. So I was right about the stickiness. So that's the term I like to use for this is emotional equity, and that's equity in the same sense as equity in your home, equity of putting money in a savings account. Once you do music and it has some emotional power for the audience, it's like putting it in a savings account. You can withdraw it later and use it again. And you have the emotions that went with it are now part of what you can do. So I learned from one of my teachers at USC, David Raxson, who was a great film composer. He actually, one of his first jobs was working with Charlie Chaplin on Modern Times, which was Charlie Chaplin's first sound film. And he wrote music with Charlie. He also ended up years later doing the score to a movie called Laura, which is has the theme to Laura is the most re-recorded theme in movie history. And his mentor was Alfred Newman, who is the godfather of all film composers, literally related to half of Hollywood's film composers. Lionel Newman, Thomas Newman, Randy Newman, they're all related to Alfred. And David went to him and said, hey, I've got this theme for Laura, but I think I'm using it too much in the film. And he says, I think people are going to get tired of it. And Alfred told him, if you have a bad theme, then you shouldn't be using it at all. But if you have a good theme, play the hell out of it. So I took that advice into my own work. And in Halo, just Halo 1, I'm going to play just a medley of all the different pieces in Halo 1 that basically rely on the emotional equity of that music you've already heard. So if you're not familiar with the music I just played very much, this is your first time hearing it, you might not have recognized all this, but it's all the way through all these other pieces. There's the monk melody again. So all of you kids who were playing Halo, you probably didn't know why the whole thing seemed to feel like it all went together. It was because I was playing on emotional equity. Hear it? It's right in there. There's the melody. I probably played this in every key I could. And so the last thing I want to talk about is that because I was able to keep using that music and spin it out over many Halo projects, the ending of the final Halo of the trilogy, Halo 1, 2, and then 3, the final scene in the Halo trilogy, I was able to pay off all that emotional equity in this final scene. So I'm going to play that for you now. Once again, yes, I did what Alfred Newman said, play the hell out of it.
I thought I'd lost you too.
What happened?
I'm not sure. When Halo fired, it shook itself to pieces. Did a number on the Ark. The portal couldn't sustain itself. We made it through just as it collapsed. Well, some of us made it. did it. Truth and the Covenant, the Flood. It's finished.
It's finished.
I'll drop the beacon, but it'll be a while before anyone finds us. Years, even. I miss you.
Wake me when you need me.
So that's my journey through my career in games and game audio and music. So, obrigado. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Marty. Man, Halo, it's different. all right. Any questions for Martin? There you go.
Hi. First, thank you for your presentation. It was very, very, very interesting.
Thanks.
So, as most of us here, we're all pretty much engineers. Some of us want to get into the games industry. We're working on our portfolios with something, but it's not something that we particularly do as like a part of our studies. It's something most of us are trying to pursue as a hobby. And sometimes I find it's hard to focus when it's not your main goal, at least while you're studying. Do you have any advice for people who want to try to find some focus in their more creative side while also pursuing a more normal job track, if that makes any sense?
Yeah, you know, it's the engineers that I've known and the programmers that I've known over the years. I mean, actually, when I was at USC, after I got my master's in music composition, I thought, you know, I think this computer thing might take off. That's how old that is. And so I took 14 units of computer science at a junior college after I got my master's, because I wanted to know what computers were going to do. And so I took a couple of programming languages and, you know, some general computer programming classes, COBOL and Fortran. Anybody? but, you know, the thing I learned was that it's just a way of getting things done, right? It is just a logical set of steps for getting something done. And I knew from that moment on, no programmer would ever be able to just pull the wool over my eyes and say, oh, you just don't understand. So I loved working with programmers at the video game companies. And the programmers there are very, some of the top level programming people I've ever met. Graphics programmers, you know, gameplay design programmers. It's just some amazing stuff. But almost all of them had a passion for playing games. They love playing games, and they wanted to figure out how to do that thing using programming. So I'm not sure exactly, like, as an engineer, you're going to learn all sorts of programming languages. You're going to learn all sorts of techniques, and then you can go into any field you want. So it seems to me, I mean, if you want to go into banking, fine, go into the banking field. You want to like program airline stuff and whatever, do that. But if you are a creative person at all, there's so many places in the film business, in the games, especially games now. It's just a booming field for engineers. So I would definitely take a close look at that. If you have any creative interest at all, it's a great place to work. So
thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much for your talk, Martin. As a game designer slash director, I find myself having a bit of difficulty communicating with my composer. and my audio designer. So do you have any tips on more efficiently communicating with my audio director?
So this happened in every business I've been in, is communication between a director and a composer, game designer and a composer, or audio person. You basically probably deal with two different kinds of languages. And the thing I always appreciated is I felt it was more incumbent upon me to learn more about what the director or the person I'm working with wanted. But one thing I always asked them to do was, especially if they could speak, especially when it comes to music, if they could speak in emotional language and tell me what they want people to feel. That's the most important thing. But if you say, yeah, I want it to be more like Duran Duran, except with a flugelhorn, right? It's like now you're handcuffing your musician. You're giving them, do this specific thing that I like. But if you say, I need it to sound, you know, more hip hop, or I need it to, I wish this was made it people feel more spooky and scared, and or I want them to feel, you know, tension and, you know, anticipation for what's going to happen next. Give me some emotional language. And so speak in emotional terms. This is what you want the player to feel like. And a composer, hopefully a good composer, will give you some options on that. And you can say, you know what, that doesn't make me feel spooky. It makes me feel goofy, which I've had someone say to me. But that's really a good note, because then I'm going, okay, well, whatever that was that I thought was spooky doesn't make this guy feel scared and spooky. So I'm gonna change it up. But emotional language is the best for musicians.
Thank you.
Hello.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Oh yeah.
So first of all, I really wanted to say that the presentation was really cool. Like, I was here like, who's this guy? And then I heard the Halo theme song, and I was like, damn, okay, this is cool. So the question I wanted to ask was, like, gaming industry has a bad rep for people, I don't know how to say the word, but manipulate you to work harder for your passion. And I wanted to ask if you think that happened in your career, like if people manipulated your passion and make you work harder or longer, or other people in that you knew. Yeah, that's it.
Well, if you're talking about crunch.
What's crunch?
Crunch, okay. Well, crunch is what almost every game ends up doing, which is like all the games that you saw that I was showing here today, we almost had a 3-year development process for each one. Halo took 3 years, Halo 2 took 3 years, Halo 3 took 3 years. That is a long development cycle, and you have the teams got bigger and bigger, and they are, everybody on the team has a creative passion. And what can happen is you get to the end and nobody feels like it's good enough yet, and the deadline is coming up and everybody wants to work extra hours, and that's crunch. So you end up with 100 hours a week, you end up sleeping under your desk, you end up, you know, eating nothing but pizza. And that's not good. That's not good, because most of the time that passion that everybody has, sometimes it leads to better things, and there's always a little bit of crunch that needs to happen. But the corporations that I think depend on that and plan for that, that's a bad thing. You don't want to be at a place that is forcing the employees to crunch.
Yeah, yeah, and I think some companies do that.
Yeah.
And yeah, I want to know your opinion on that. Like, if it's crunch, if it's your passion, I don't think it's a bad thing. Like, in the last week, you want to do more things that you like. But yeah, some companies, they have bad rep for doing that, like in the whole process. And I wanted to know your opinion.
My opinion about the companies that force people to do that, or?
I mean, how do you discover that companies that do that, or if it happened with you?
Well, I mean, there are, especially now, it's a much more mature industry. When we were doing it, we were sort of making it up as we went along. We depended on people's passion. But now there are corporations that depend on forcing people into some sort of horrible ending period where for months at a time they're just working nonstop. And when you identify companies that do that, you just want to avoid those. I would just go not work for them. When I had teams of people that would crunch and work hard and, you know, be up late, a lot of times we finally realized, hey, we just need to tell those guys to go home. You just need to go home. You can't squeeze blood from a stone, right? Like, and if you come in the next day and you're completely burned out because you stayed up working until 3 o'clock in the morning, you're not going to be any good the next day. So, you know, I hate talking about work-life balance because work and life, it's all one big thing. But to have enough balance in your life where the work you're doing is effective and good. So sometimes you need managers that actually say, it's time for you to go home, get some rest, take the weekend off. You know, we know we got a deadline, but we're going to try to be better at planning. So a lot of times that's management problems. I don't know if I answered your question or not.
Yeah, it's your opinion. Yeah, I wanted that. Thank you, Martin.
Okay.